Hello. I've got a cat prowling around my desk. You find it? Give me you.
Oh.
This is Kaneko. Say hi, buddy. Jeez. Oh. Or fuck off.
What a beauty, though.
Yeah, he's nice, but he's a little sketch at the moment. I don't think he likes the lights.
Oh.
Or something. I don't know. He's kind of a sketchy cat.
Okay, so it looks... I'm crossing my fingers that the Zoom link is going to work for everybody. I just have an irrational fear that it won't.
Yeah. Well, I use the one in the invite, in the calendar invite. Maybe I can leave and try to join with the one in the on the wiki and just make sure, validate that I come back to the same place. Let me do that.
Thanks. Okay. Hi, Julian.
Hi, Michael.
Ross is testing the link that went out on social media. He's, yay, he's back. Thank you, Ross.
It's the right one.
Hey.
So what link did you put?
Did I click on?
Yeah, just curious because let me just check.
Here, I'll share my screen. I'll show you where I click.
Okay, it's a bit.ly. Okay, it gets me there. Yeah,
I went here actually into the wiki, and then I scrolled down here, clicked there, copied it from there. That's how I did it.
Nice. By the way, yeah, the OpenLineage wiki needs also some improvement.
Yeah, that would be a good project to sort of assess both of those wikis and see what can be done.
Yeah, and it's kind of what goes in the wiki versus on the website versus on GitHub.
Mm-hmm.
There's a bit of, right now for OpenLineage, the only thing that goes on the wiki is a meeting note.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the link is there. Yeah, that works. Well, by Julian and them, maybe we need to change that. Hello, MeQ.
Hey, MeQ.
Hello.
Hey, everybody.
Hey, Kevin.
Hello.
Hello, Kevin.
How's it going?
Pretty good.
Love the stash, Ross.
Thanks. Yeah, it's, you know, it's coming in.
Nice.
How's it going?
Hey, John.
All right, I'm just getting set up here. Oops, that's the wrong screen, I think. That's okay. Yeah, that's the one I want to share. Okay, that's better. Cool. I think we can start. It's about 5 after. So should we kick it off? Yeah, let's do it. Okay, well, welcome everyone to the first Marcus Community meeting of 2022. So welcome. The agenda today, we're going to go through it quickly. We have a few things lined up, and I know Peter's not here, but I know he worked on a recent hack that allows you to start up Marquez, and I think it's called using Gitpods. So if I don't know if he's on the call, but if not, I think we should totally demo it on his behalf, because I think there's a lot of really cool things that you can do with that.
I'm here, but you can demo it.
Oh, no, Peter, that's all you. I didn't see you on the call. So I know we haven't done intros in a while, so maybe we do that just because it looks like quite a few people are on the call and might as well. So Julian, you're first on my screen.
Hello, I'm Julian. I'm the CTO of Datakin and also the lead for the OpenLineage project.
Yeah, welcome, Julian. Ross, you're up.
Hi, I'm a VP marketing for Datakin, and I also help out in the community stuff when I can and when there's a need.
Yeah, and the other day I saw some interesting market material or a new website for Marquez that I'm excited to possibly see in the future. I love what you're doing, so excited to see that become available in the future. So cool, welcome. Oh, and Kevin, welcome. Haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah. Hi. So yeah, Kevin, I work with a group of data engineers at Northwestern Mutual, and we've been building within and on top of Marquez for probably almost a year now, I would say. So really excited to be at the meeting.
Very cool. Welcome. John?
Hi, I'm John. I'm a support engineer at Datakin. I work with Ross on his team doing kind of helping keep an eye on the community and managing kind of a lot of the comms and Slack and otherwise. So coming to Slack, you'll probably meet me.
Yeah, I've been seeing you fielding a lot of the questions. It's been great. Thanks for doing that. And I think we have new issues because of that. So very cool. And Peter, who, you know, impromptu will do a demo today. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Peter, software engineer at Datakin. Yeah, I'm a Marquez contributor.
Cool, and we have Michael.
Hi, a developer relations engineer with Datakin, and can I call myself a new contributor to Marquez? I think as of yesterday.
Oh, absolutely. You touched over like 500 files. Yeah, you are, you're a committer.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for opening that PR. Yeah, it was around licensing if people were interested. And Minku?
I'm Minku, and software engineer at Datakin. And yeah, I am also a contributor to Marquez.
Yeah, I think we have a few of your commits that are going to be in Marquez 021. That's great. And Michael, you're just in time. Or Mike, I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry, you have to distinguish between us now. There's too many of us. Mike, been working on Marquez for close to a year now. Software engineer at Datakin. That's it.
Awesome. And I think that's everyone. Great. Oh, and I guess myself, yeah. I'm Willie, software engineer at Datakin, co-creator of Marquez. And I kind of run these community meetings for now, but I think I've been talking to Michael, and he's been doing a pretty great job with announcements and around the community meeting and when it's happening around Slack. So I think we'll be doing some transitioning there. So excited for that. Just to get more people involved in the process. So some quick announcements here. I just wanted to say, you know, Marquez has been in development for a while now. I think it's maybe 4 years since WeWork, early days of WeWork, and we're close to 1,000 stars. And I think that's a pretty big milestone for the project. I don't know what we're gonna do about that. I know we have like Marquez stickers, so maybe people who want Marquez stickers can get them. But I think we should definitely celebrate this because it's such a huge milestone for the project. And I just want to say we're less than 80 stars away. So if you know any friends in the data space, or maybe not, they just have a GitHub account, please let them know about the project. And it's great that.
I think everyone should get a copy of 100 Years of Solitude.
There you go. Right. Julie already has his. I have mine. But yeah, that's a book everyone should know. That's
and then your language, though.
Oh, what was that? There was
are we going to get? Are we going to get the English version or the Spanish version?
Oh, you know, it has been translated in a number of languages. So you're right.
But it's been written in Spanish, so maybe the original edition.
The OG one. Yeah, all those are great ideas. Let's throw them on the Slack channel and what ways we could celebrate this. I think that'd be fun. And the one thing I just wanted to say, you know, for those on the call and those that are going to be watching after or that couldn't make it, I just wanted to kind of put a little shout out here. Since also Julian is here, the Open Lineage is such a key part of Marquez in terms of the project going forward. And especially in this release, we're removing all the different runs APIs that you had access to as we transition completely to Open Lineage. I just want to make a quick announcement there. If you want to check out the project, it's openlineage.io and it has linked to GitHub and the project. And you can learn more about how to use Open Lineage. And there's various blogs that have been written by a number of people on this call. And there's a Northwestern one, so Kevin as well. So we're transitioning completely over to that. To using that standard. So I just want to make a shout out that you can join the Slack channel and the next meeting point, let's spell that incorrectly. What did I do here? Attend the next meeting on, okay, well, that didn't, I'll just update this in real time. So yeah, it's next month on the 9th for those who wanted to attend. And yeah, you could find more details on the website or the repo. So two things here, but I think we could also start. We could demo. It was called Gitpods, and I'll put it.
It's singular.
Okay, the Gitpod. And disappear. Okay, this thing. Cool. Right, so I'm going to be sharing these slides after, so might as well just add a link here. Cool. And so yeah, we'll talk about 021, and not a whole lot in this one. I think there are some general bug fixes and some removal. There's a lot of removal of code. It's always a good thing. But I think in 022, there'll be more exciting stuff coming out. And then we'll do the demo that Peter has for Try Marquez with Gitpod. So yeah, this is an interesting one. And Kevin, it'll be interesting to get your feedback on this. So we moved to Java 17 for Marquez. So we've migrated the Marquez API image. So when we build Docker, we now use Java 17. And we're using the, I don't even know how to pronounce this, Tumarin, is that correct? Pronunciation of that. This will allow us to build different architectures. And that was one key thing that we saw a lot in Marquez when someone was trying to kind of deploy locally using Docker. There was the recently with Mac and their change of CPU architecture, they had issues starting. So now we're just using Tumarin for macOS. And there's different, I mean, obviously there's different distributions based off other platforms. Just want to make a note of that. So we've changed all the CI deployment to do Java 17, and the Marquez API, the images, so all those are now on Java 17. So that was a contribution that happened from someone external, which was great. They kind of pushed us to move to Java 17, and there was a little bit of follow-up work after that to get the deployment or to get the build working locally. But we addressed those, and we should be able to pull down the changes and start install Java 17 and start contributing in Rene Marquez locally.
Yeah, and just a real quick question, Willie. Do you know, did that include the Java client as well, or just the internal code?
The Java client as well. I know you're on using 1.8 at the moment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. I can play around with it and see how it works. Appreciate the heads up.
Yeah. So it was one of those things where it's like, well, do we just move everything all together? And that's kind of what we did. Because I think the Java client was on Java 11, if I'm not mistaken. It was aligned with the Marquez API.
Okay. Yeah. And just for context, like I know it's weird to be on an older version of Java. A lot of our stuff is around being able to run inside of like Databricks DBRs, which are old versions of Java, but I'm sure there's a fancy way to get around it. So we'll take a look.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, let us know what happens. You know, if there are big concerns, I'm wondering if we have different distributions, or maybe we pin it to a lower environment, a lower version. But yeah, communicate with us, and we'll try to work with you to see what we can do.
Yeah, sounds good.
At the very least, we can always make it binary compatible with Java 1.8. The tricky part is making sure that we don't use library features from 17, and then you get runtime issues.
Sure. Yeah, and I don't want to like limit what you can do as well. So yeah, hopefully there's a happy medium somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Yeah, and so the next point here, the removal of the integration. So, you know, we had the Marquez Airflow integration, and okay, this is just pointing to, prior to, as of a few weeks ago, we no longer have an integration directory. If I go to just previous releases, you can see what I'm talking about there, like 1.19. We had this integration directory where it had Airflow and Spark, and really there was not much going on here. It was just simply wrapping the integration or the open lineage DAG. If we go to the code here, that's really all was happening there. So what we were doing, we had CI sort of build this and also run integration tests, which added close to 5 minutes to our builds. So at some point we knew that we no longer wanted to distribute this artifact. And it at the time when we started upgrading to Java 17, we ran into issues just trying to maintain the Spark library, and because that's what I was using 1.8. So you had this mix of different Java versions that required us to do a bit more work on the CI side. And since it's been deprecated for quite some time now, we decided, you know what, now might be a good time and communicate with everyone in the community that, you know, you can still use this library. Like, we're not removing it from the ones we distributed already. It's just going forward, if you want changes that have been worked on in the Spark integration, we recommend just moving over to the using the Open Lineage Spark integration. So I wanted to point out in this, so, you know, it's also in the change logs, but if you're migrating to Open Lineage Airflow, there's different ways to configure the client, and you can in your Airflow instance. So I recommend going to the docs there. You can use just a standard import change. So openlineage.airflow, it no longer becomes, it's interesting that this, there should be an underscore here. It's missing to be Okay, you can't even see it. That's interesting. I'll let it go. But just know there's supposed to be another square there. That's not showing up. But I think going forward, you know, there's been really great work that's being done on the open lineage side with Airflow that allows you to use this task listener. So then, and you could use that via a plugin. So there's more docs that are going to come out. So there's good reason to migrate to open lineage because you don't have to modify the imports anymore if you don't want to, because as the newer versions of open lineage Airflow comes out, there's more seamless integration with Airflow that's coming out. So if you might start migrating now, you can still use this import change, but just know down the road, there's more simple ways to get up and running with open lineage and Airflow and send that metadata to the Marquez backend. And similar with Spark, really here you're just modifying the package that you're downloading from Maven and also just the Spark listener. It's really the only two changes there. I didn't point this out in my slides, but they are in the changelog. So here, just more clear on what we're doing, kind of outlines the import change, but the environment variables that you configure for your Airflow instance are also changed. So we're just Marquez URL, open lineage, and the same thing for the namespace. And yeah, so I just want to point that out. If you're using the environment variables, then those change as well. There was some discussion and stuff that I wanted to go into, but I think what we would like, Peter, if you wanted to talk about maybe your hack that you did this week, and I'll give you the, let's figure this out. So I just want to stop sharing. I've used Zoom before. Okay, it's just on my right screen here.
So what we now have available in the Marquez README is something that a new button that says open in Gitpod that allows you to create a cloud-based instance of Marquez and all of its elements. So you get all of the Docker components, which are the database, the UI and the backend. So all you have to do to kind of try out the project now is click this button, and we kind of immediately start up a VS Code instance inside the cloud, and we start pulling the Docker images that we push to remote. So we see that kind of going down at the bottom of the screen here. And so this is really great for somebody who's just wants to try out the project, but isn't ready to commit and pull everything down, or they're maybe having issues running it locally on their operating system, like we've seen recently in the community. So the process here is really fast. It takes, I think it's about 30 seconds to get everything started. So now we see the database migrations running here. Soon we'll start seeing the seed data going. So what I have here now, I got a pop-up blocked by my browser, but what we get here is this URL that is Marquez and has the UI in it. So we can look at our seed data in our kind of our food delivery canonical example, browse the data sets, do this, searches works as well. And so this is kind of just available as a resource for anyone looking to kind of trash a Marquez instance if they don't know what they're doing and don't want to commit to anything. And all of this gets cleaned up after 30 minutes of inactivity. So there's nothing really to worry about in terms of, you know, causing any damage to anything. The other thing that's available is the API itself is available. So we can go to the namespaces, and you'll see we just get a response from our namespaces API here. So And this also works for, you know, any open lineage event, any job data set listing. And you can kind of do whatever you want here. It can also be made private or public here on the left-hand side. So if you want to share the link for this Marquez instance, you can do that. If you make it public, the web is public by default. Everything else is private by default. And you can also do anything you could in a VS Code editor. So you can edit the code, you can stop this terminal from running, you can rerun it from the terminal, and you can kind of do anything you could in your local IDE just in this cloud-based environment. And you get this deployed instance, which is pretty nice, and it works pretty quickly. So yeah, that's kind of the demo, so.
Yeah, that's amazing, Peter. I think what we've seen a lot is someone comes to the project, they want to POC it for their organization, and they just want to get Marquez running locally and just to kind of use metadata that they have internally and then eventually take screenshots and advocate for using Marquez internally. But this streamlines that whole process. They could get up and running, they have a shareable link, they have an endpoint that they can use to hit the API. And I think a lot of those questions that we field in Slack are now going to be maybe not existed, but I think it's going to get the setup, local setup a lot quicker.
Yeah, I guess another thing to watch for is kind of our Docker pull metrics as well with this. I think they'll likely increase because we have this now and we're doing all these Docker pulls for each click here.
Are there any ways we could get metrics on Gitpod in general, since we configure it with Marquez, just to see if people are using it or no, there's no metrics there?
Not that I know of, but it may be worth looking into.
Yeah, that's awesome, ahead. Peter. Just a quick question. I haven't used Gitpod before. Do you just have to set up for like a free account, or does it just launch right into it?
So it's just going to launch right into it. It's just going, it authenticates across GitHub. So
okay.
You just have to click a button to authorize GitHub, your GitHub cool. account.
Yeah, so that's really cool.
That's about it. Yep.
And you're giving them away your email address you'd see when you do that. So basically, that's what you have to pay for free use of that infrastructure.
Okay, yeah. I've given away more.
All right, nice. But yeah, that was just something that Peter worked on this week for. We had a hack day at Datakin. And that was something that we thought we wanted to also share with the community, because we thought it was pretty slick. Okay, so let me get back to my slides. Yeah, and the next is just open discussion. Maybe we could take a second. Does anyone want to discuss anything? Is there anything pressing for them that they would like to add to the list here? I'd be happy to edit it.
I have just one discussion for not like a super important one, but just kind of wanted to talk a little bit about Circle CI versus GitHub Actions, just because Actions seems to be picking up a bit. Just curious if people have thoughts or opinions on either of those. It's kind of looking more for our automated, you know, validation pieces, and noticed some cool stuff in there around Helm charts that could be used, but.
Well, for one, Circle CI has been having a lot of outages recently. It's one of those things where you've already configured already have something in place. For us, we're using Circle CI, but I have seen a lot of projects move over to GitHub Actions. And I haven't personally done a lot of research on it, just because we're on Circle CI. But it seems to be a more seamless integration with your code. And you could do a lot more things, I guess, based off if something happens, you can trigger a certain workflow. I don't know, Kevin.
Seems like the marketplace for GitHub Actions is really starting to take off as well. And I think there's a way to just run exactly what would happen in GitHub Actions locally pretty easily. But I haven't done that myself. That's just something I saw there.
That's probably the single biggest argument for using it in the first place I've heard so far.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that sounds nice. I think we just didn't have time to look into it is the main reason. I think another thing we discussed that might work better in GitHub Action is, you know, when we have integration tests that use some of the secrets that are in the CI build, like connecting to, a BigQuery account or some or things like that, right? So that prevents us from giving forked PRs to build automatically, because otherwise we allow anyone to run, you know, it's just Bitcoin mining on this, on those accounts, right? Or something. It's open on the internet. And I think with GitHub Actions, there's a nicer workflow to kind of approve PRs so that they run using those secrets, and we know they're not going to leak them. So that was another argument, but we didn't have time to dig into that. And maybe that's more of an open lineage issue.
Do you know if we can still SSH onto a worker to test your action?
I do not know. I know with what I've seen, there's like a pretty robust UI inside of GitHub where you can go and see the logs and the failed steps and that kind of thing. But aside from that, I haven't really gone into it.
We also have that issue with the billing in Circle CI, right? With the limited builds and them not running all of the time, which I think is a bit of a pain. If GitHub has a solution for that, I would be pretty interested.
Yeah, I think the Circle CI is this free plan for open source projects. And it's kind of difficult. You're either on the free plan or you're on the paid plan. But it's hard for an open source, someone to add more credit to the free plan for an open source project by paying to this, right? Because when you're on the paid plan, you pay per seat, which for an open source project is kind of annoying, right? Like every contributor, you have to pay a seat. Where on the free plan, it's a number of credits and some level of parallelism, which is, you can't really increase, like say a company donates a number of credits to increase this pool.
Okay. Well, I can experiment a bit. I just wanted to make sure there wasn't a reason to not look at GitHub Actions, but yeah, I've got a bit of an interest in this anyways. So I'd be happy to see what I learned and share it out.
Yeah, I think it would be great. Sorry, go ahead, Weedy.
I was just going to say the same exact thing, Julian. And if you get to the point where you feel pretty comfortable kind of using GitHub Actions at Northwestern, then I don't see why Marquez can't switch over. I think sure. That'd be great. And something you could contribute. It looks like Circle CI is like, yeah, GitHub Actions are great. I don't know what that means, but I think they just wanted their logo there. CI and CD is awesome. Interesting.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I think we can run both in parallel for a while and see, you know, and at some point we can switch over or something.
Yeah, so maybe Kevin, next community meeting, or I'm not kind of putting this on your plate, but as you get more comfortable, it'd be great for you to give the community kind of an overview of what you learned and talk about maybe switching over to GitHub Actions.
Yeah, sounds good.
Very cool. I just wanted to bring so there have been things around questions in the community around deleting metadata. There's an issue here, and I wanted more. I think people to chime in. This was first opened by Frank Cash. I think there's another issue as well that talks about this, Julian, that you opened, and I don't think I linked it up.
I think there's an equivalent one on the OpenInitch side, and we ought to really start documenting what this would look like. I think it makes a lot of sense, right? It's just something that's been kicked down the road a few times. And we should just do it.
Yeah, ability to delete jobs. Okay, I think this is what you talked about here. Also here.
Oh, I see there.
Okay, so they're linked. The reason why we just don't have a delete endpoint yet, because it makes natural sense to have it, is that there's two things you have to consider when you have a delete API for metadata. Is that one, is this a soft delete where you still want to track that the relationship in the lineage graph? At one point it existed and now it no longer does. And then the other one is a forced delete where you're just like, you know, I made a complete mistake. This job name is not correct and I want to delete it and do a forced delete. So that's why those endpoints haven't been there, just because we wanted to have a more broader discussion, especially with open lineage on what that means. Because as of recently, there has been a PR around table state change that we need to give review on. And this is coming from open lineage. And he says it closes this here. Okay, there is an issue here. So this is something, Mike, that you opened up. Or maybe, Mike, did you want to talk more about this issue?
Some of the guys who are working on the Spark integration in Open Lineage some time ago added support for some of the operations that are supported in Spark Logical Plan. So truncating tables, dropping tables, changing states in various forms. And one of the things that they did was they created a new Open Lineage facet that reports those state changes, but we don't do anything with that information in Marquez, right? So right now we're just, we'll write it to the lineage events table. And that's it. So like you can see it in the UI. If you look at the facets for a data set, you can see that there were state change facets attached to it, but that's not really that helpful. If you're looking at a graph, you kind of want to know if a table's been deleted not without having to click on every single data set and look at all of the facets that are attached to each one, right? We talked about adding support for state changes. And actually doing something with that information. So the PR that's open right now just has a state change column added. And the way it is right now, I think the screenshot that they have posted was just showing that there was a state change. You've got that up there. So it's showing that there was a state change. And we kind of talked about whether or not we want to, just display that as a raw column in the table there, or if we wanted to use that information to do something a little bit more informative in the UI.
It's something I agree with you, Julian, and it's one of those things where it's been talked about in different scenarios by different groups of people, and it's got to the point where I think we need to have a more formal proposal on deleting. I don't know, Kevin, have you had to delete metadata? And if so, how did you do it? Or did that request ever come up?
Yeah, it's a request that we've kind of struggled with as well, because a lot of the times you want to almost protect the requester against what they're asking for. Sometimes people think of it in terms of like, I just want to delete this, but I don't really think about the fact that I need this downstream. The case you brought up of, I misnamed a job, that makes a lot of sense. But the ones that get a little more complex for us is like data retention and how that fits into overall metadata strategies, and not really a super clear answer there yet.
Yeah.
To me, I just wanted to add to your earlier comment, really, to me, it means it is a soft delete, right? Because you may say the dataset is deleted as a job, it is deleted. And so you don't see it in the current view, but you know it's run before, right? So you can find the metadata if you need to, and if you rename the job, you should have the ability to link, the new name to the old name and know that things have changed this way. Mm-hmm. So to me, it's a sub-delete. Like Marquez, since the older model is version, you create a new version that's marked as deleted. That's probably some new column in the database or in the model. And then that means it can be recreated. When someone deletes a data set and creates it again, you can still see the history there.
I see. So you always view deletions as soft deletes then?
I would think so, right? And eventually the metadata can be deleted with a retention policy once we have this implemented.
I see.
But otherwise the delete is more of a soft delete. It's saying the data set has been deleted, that the job doesn't exist anymore. But that doesn't change that it has run in the past, right? And that's what Marquez is tracking.
Yeah, and that makes a lot of sense to me. I think the retention discussions are really more trying to align like corporate policy to modern tech stacks, you know, like realizing the metadata is not data. but yeah, no, I like the idea of the soft elite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm just throwing this out there. I'm also wondering for users that don't want deletion at all to happen, would it make sense to deploy Marquez in two modes where you can do deletes, where it exposes the delete endpoints, the other one where it's just write only, or supports both? Or is that just too complex? Like, there's no reason to have a flag based, like Marquez can now do delete and read metadata.
No, I think it's just an evolution of the system, right? Like you add deletes and
okay.
Well, I think when you get the data set, it doesn't exist anymore, but if you get the versions, then you see the history, right? Something like that. We would have to put that in a design doc, I think. I'll kind of spell that out.
Okay. This is another one I added. This issue, I wanted to bring up that we don't have the node IDs right now, and you have to build them yourselves. So when you do a lineage call, right, you have to understand how the node ID is formatted. You have to know like the format that we have, whether it's prefix with job or data set, and what are the components. This is like an easy win that we should have as well, so we could start having more and more users use our lineage API. So we're gonna add a field that just returns back the node ID in the models. This is just something I wanted to bring up, because it's kind of like long overdue, and we just haven't prioritized it. So within the job, within the models themselves, you'll just have node ID, and then you could query the lineage API with that node ID. And that's what I wanted to bring up. And the one thing as well is we don't have the lineage call in our Java client. That's something that's missing. So if you wanted to kind of automate your workflows in some way using the lineage API that Marquez has, there's a gap there. You can only use the REST API. So if you're using bash scripts and stuff, that's one way to do it, but we wanted it to be a bit more seamless using our clients. So just wanted to bring that up. Something we could prioritize for the next Marquez release. That's all I had. Okay, so anything else? If not, I think we could kind of conclude a little early. Cool. So it was really great to see everyone again. We'll try to get the 021 out as soon as we can, maybe by early next week, or today's Thursday, so we'll see. But for sure, by sometime next week. And again, Kevin, let us know about binary incompatibilities. Like Mike said, we could do some stuff which limits us, but if you're having this problem, I think others will. So it's important to just bring that up before we do a release.
Sure, yeah, I'll let you know.
Cool. Well, all right, everyone. Thanks for joining, and I'll see everyone next time.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good meeting.
All right. Bye.
All right.